Give y'all a little brief interlude. How y'all doing, y'all?
Hey, family.
What's going on? I know I'm late, y'all. Don't judge me. So I had to get, you see, I gave y'all a little 5 minute song. You know, the Lord worked it on that. Let me take a sip. Woo chow. Running around here like a chicken with my hair cut off, but I got it together. Oh, goodness gracious. Let's see. Well, hey, Joe. Yes, for the hard ass. Thank you. Get me together. It's always when you have something to do and stuff just be popping up, honey. Just be coming out of nowhere. Okay. You know me. I'm getting my notes together. You know, y'all know I got to turn my mug. My mug today says, "How beautiful are you?" My mama bought me this mug, so it means a lot to me. I beat the heck out of this face, y'all. I wish you could have seen me here trying to put lashes on. It was a lot. Just know that it was a lot. I had a lot going on, but I got it together. You know what I'm saying? All right, so today's show, for me, and I feel like for me and... you know, my team, this is like a highly anticipated show. So this wonderful, wonderful, wonderful woman, extremely talented. She goes by Lammy. She is an artist, y'all. And when I say artist, I do not use that term lightly. I mean an artiste. She's an artiste. So I'm going to give you a little background on Lammy before I bring her on in. So, yes. Is reading her notes. I'm a professional. You know, I'm not like Oprah with a teleprompter. You know, I gotta give you what I can give you right now. So, background on Lammy. So, she is a self-taught painter and an artist specializing in metal point. We will obviously get down to what exactly metal point is, if you don't already know. Her main focus is creating positive images of women and people of color in precious metals like 24 karat gold, silver, and platinum. She uses the aesthetics of the 15th century technique and widely used during the Renaissance period and applies them to her imagery of Afrofuturism. Mouthful, y'all, but I got it. So, little background. She's originally from Harlem and Brooklyn, New York. She lived in Atlanta and most recently New Orleans. And now she has graced Chicago with her presence and she has moved here. So, with that being said, in that introduction that I just gave y'all off the fly, we're going to go ahead and we're going to bring her in. All right. We're adding her now, folks. I'll get rid of this. It's going to be good, y'all. It's going to be good.
Oh. Wait. I don't know. Okay, I got the chain.
There
got
we it. Go. There she is.
I was like,
That's what happens. As soon as you go live, it's like you got to flip the camera. You got to flip the script.
I thought I had it all together, and then all of a sudden I went,
That's how anyway. It happens. But hey, how are you?
How are you?
Oh
how
gosh, are you? Finally meet.
We had I know.
What I feel like a month. It feels like I know. A month already.
It what? But can you believe the month went by?
It's unfortunate. And but
I know.
But it did. It went by a little too fast for me. But you know, here we are, neither here nor there.
I hear you.
So, oh my goodness, welcome. So we did the intro. I told the folks where you're from. So just, I want them to hear from you. Give us a little bit of your background and just, you know, who you are, you know, what makes you you?
Well, the funny thing is when it comes down to the artwork that I'm doing now, it stems all the way back to when I was a child. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being raised in a Catholic school and Catholic church and everything Catholic, what I did was actually look at the signs of the cross. Mm-hmm. I found love with just the art itself of how it was very romantic to me. Mm-hmm. You know, I could give two craps about what was going on in church, although I'm a different person now.
Amen.
Yeah, when you're a kid, they're telling you what to do, and you're like, but
I gotta go. So.
I know. And you get graded for it. Anyway, so then when I discovered Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo and stuff like that, I really, you know, your heart just looks at it and it moves and stuff like that. But just in the last 5 years, mm-hmm. when I started going through, like, going to museums and stuff like that, I go, what would it be like if the world was different and we decided that we could turn around and go, do you know how beautiful those people would look if we were able to put a little bit of color, a little bit, you know? But when I say that, I'm talking about something like classic, something soft, because we're not associated with soft half the time. You know, we're associated with other things, but there's a level of history in that beauty, you know, and then bring it forth to, you know, to our time to actually show. Now, when I started doing this, and I taught myself how to do this when I went to Spain, to Barcelona.
Oh, my God.
And so it was amazing. It was for a residency, and we were actually in the fields, in the wine fields. And, you know, they got the world's best wine.
Oh, yes.
And we were going through all the materials just so we can have something to build on the metal point that we were doing, that I was doing. At the end of the day, as I brought it forth, I never saw it before, the Black Madonna.
Oh, yeah.
And then, okay, so you're looking at the Black Madonna, and then the next thing you know, conceptually, imagine doing that instead of a sculpture or a painting, actually turning around and using that technique that's 500, I mean, not 500, 15th century. Yeah, it's 500. and then bring it to what people look like now.
Mm-hmm.
And when I did that, and I showed it for the first time at the George Washington Carver Interpretive Museum in Dothan, Alabama, mm-hmm. I didn't know how people were going to take it until they felt, when they saw it, it made them feel positive mm-hmm. about themselves. And the reason why is because I took something that was precious, put it in their likeness, mm-hmm. and therefore they felt precious. They felt worthy. And so we're always wearing the jewelry.
Oh yeah. We just came up
But
with
can you imagine? Well, we just got style.
that.
But
Hello. Same. We just got styled up.
when it comes to actually being the precious metal, it took on a whole nother mind. It
Oh
took
yeah.
on, and I said, I gotta keep doing this. And because it really, like little children, but the thing that got me, it wasn't just the little children, it was the people who were 60 to 80 that felt that positivity of the likeness. And I
Right.
was so happy, doing
Yeah,
that.
because I think I've always admired art, but I've never really gotten deep into it because, like you said, I don't feel like I saw a lot of me in it. Now, we're talking 2020. Oh, yeah. We can find, people doing us people doing us anywhere. Like
I know, I
we are
know.
out there. But I feel like when I was growing up and then, being a child and I lived overseas and I lived in Spain and I lived in Japan, it was like I didn't see a lot of me in art. So to come back to the States and then now as a grown woman and I'm growing and to see myself in artwork, it's fantastic. Like it's a beautiful thing to see because I feel like it took me, 20 plus years to actually see that.
I totally get it. Now, this is the thing. You never stop growing.
Oh, yes.
If you stop growing, you're probably dead. But
More than likely.
the thing that gets me is like if you get to see things, I didn't, it's not like I didn't get it, but when I was a kid and well, when I was in 1990 actually was when I started this. And that meaning the being a full-time artist, being a painter. I worked so much on emotion. That's what got me was working on emotions like crazy. And the reason why is because we all are feeling what I'm trying to paint. Okay. So now and think of it this way. The first 20 years of me doing artwork was about me healing, about me working something out of my system, me trying to feel better about myself. If I can create something beautiful, then I've achieved being beautiful, if that makes any sense. So the next thing about that was that I self-published a book on those first 20 years. And then I said, now, how am I going to learn how to make art out of joy?
Wow.
And it took me a while. It took me a while, but I am ecstatic by the fact that whenever I'm always feeling joyous about the process. And that's the most beautiful thing that keeps me going. The process, as well as the fact that I want to create excellence and beauty so that when you see it, you say, we are brilliant.
Wow, that's
Period.
a mouthful right there.
Do you know what I
Yeah, we
mean?
can slam, slam, click it right now. She, baby. She, whoo.
Thank you.
That is amazing. And I think, just like you said, we are always growing. And it's crazy because just me, I'm only 28 years. I'll be 28 this year. So I'm only 27. So just to see where I am now and where I was 3 years ago when I moved to Chicago, I am a completely different person. Like,
And you'll be in 3 years from now,
yes.
you're
Like, I
gonna
think
be
it's
another.
crazy how we just. Like we just evolve. It's a never-ending cycle of growing.
What goes on, what I always feel like I've had many lifetimes. That's how I usually take it. You will always have the memories. You will always have the experience, but that doesn't necessarily mean you have to stay. Especially if it's a bad situation or something like that, it does not define you, and it doesn't mean that you stay. If you can dream it, you can do it. That's my philosophy.
100%.
Yeah, so.
I gotta put that in writing, put that up on the wall. If you can dream it, you can do it. All right now.
I do feel it. And always remember, you're not alone. God is always with you.
Oh, 100%. Okay, so I want to talk about Metal Point. So I watched one of your videos earlier and I was in shock because I'm like, wait a minute, wait a minute. Is she really doing what I think she's doing?
It's
So
right here.
there you
This is just
explain it to the
one.
people. What is metal point?
So metal point is actually drawing with precious metal. Now this here is silver. It's the real silver, just as silver. Well, actually, this is more silver. This is 99.9. This
Okay.
one's 925. We usually wear 925. So the silver point is usually the most common, but this here is 24 karat gold.
Okay.
And my mother-in-law actually gifted this to me. And I was like, well, how am I going to turn it into this? But you see the round edges?
Perfect.
I was able to do a silver, not a silver point, a metal point of 73 inches by 58. It's at Galerie Guichard right now.
Wow.
Took me months to do. It took me, I started it in New Orleans and then I finished it when I got here.
Wow.
And it took me months to do, but it's one of those pieces that I'm extremely proud of because it's part of the Indigo 7 series, which I've been doing. It's blue background, and I'm bringing like brass and gold. You know, when you see
Yes.
that, well, you see like this here, but there's one like right here, and that one is a woman. She's done in copper, and
Okay.
then her surroundings, like her skin is copper, her body shape is a real woman, you
That is
know.
like it speaks for itself. That the fact
Yeah.
that you can do like you're doing a woman's body out of that richness because it's
Yeah.
rich. Like when you see it,
That's it.
especially
That's
with
the
the
thing.
blue, it's
Yes.
so rich and it resonates for itself. Like when you see copper and silver against that blue background, like that's powerful.
But the thing is, if you see it, mind you, it's metal. So what you're actually looking at is the reflection of light on the metal. And it can't be like you're looking at me right now and you're seeing the light on me. But you see here, I work on things like that. I work on this. I work on the highlights of the body, of the fabric, of the folds in the fabric, so that when the light hits it at the right moment, you are so drawn into it that you're just like, oh my God, I can't. And the reason why I love it so much is because it warms up the house. I create it in daylight, I create it in natural light, but then as the day goes on and the lighting in your house changes, it changes with you. And it's almost like mood feeling, and it brings warmth. It brings, you know, that whole feeling of what you know. I love
I love
it,
it. I, look,
basically.
let's not be in my price range. It's gonna be hanging up right here on the spot. Look, I got a spot for it. We're already ready.
Well,
Got it ready.
I'm glad.
Yep. We'll talk. We'll talk.
Yeah.
So, you grew up in Harlem and Brooklyn, New York. You moved to Atlanta. You moved to New Orleans. I could say why Chicago. Heck, I picked Chicago, so I know why. But why did you choose Chicago of all places?
Okay, so the gallery that I'm in now is Galerie Guichard. It's in Brownsville. The most amazing thing is in New Orleans, I applied for the Bombay Sapphire Artisan Series. Do you know what that is?
I haven't heard.
Okay, so Bombay Sapphire is the liquor. They're a sponsor.
Oh,
They
yes,
do
I
an
know the liquor. Yes.
artisan series. Yeah, but they do an, okay. And they pick key cities around the United States. Chicago's one of them, but the main group of people are here at Galerie Guichard.
Okay.
They have New York, Atlanta, they have New Orleans, although I don't think they're doing New Orleans anymore. San Francisco, Toronto, you know, they're doing all that. Anyway, in 2017, I applied and I won New Orleans.
Wow.
And so I ended up going to Art Basel as, you know, to compete nationally.
Wow.
I didn't get in, but, you know, my art was there. And then I got invited by the gallery to, they invited me to ask if I wanted to be a part of it. So part of their gallery. So I was like, yes, I was excited. So shipped the artwork, came up to do the first show. Me and my husband looked everywhere and we're like, Oh my God, I think we're cheating on New York.
Yeah.
And the reason why I say that is because we, our love is for New York. You know, we love our New York. But
The
when we
Queen.
came here,
Yes.
we were like, and okay. You know what I mean?
Next, we gotta go.
Yeah, and that was in 2018. So then I came two more times. He came twice. The second time, he actually applied for a job and got it. And so we were like, hello.
Gotta go.
Yeah, we're gone. And the fact that I work with the gallery here already, it just felt like a no-brainer, you know. And the thing that made me very happy was that they were the gallery that actually saw the work and they loved it and they knew. They didn't see anything like it ever. Or maybe they said I've never seen anything like this. So what happened was that the fact that I had all this body of work from Barcelona and from New Orleans, they said, they have it, and they love. I'm so happy I have, that to work on with me.
Oh, yeah, I gotta take a field trip. Are they
You
open?
like. Come, they're doing something in, I think it's the 17th. I'll send you the information.
Okay,
And
yes.
it's a woman's show.
Oh, I'll be there.
So not only is it a woman's show, but also we're going to be doing an artist talk.
Oh,
Yeah, yeah.
yes, I definitely have to be there for that. Sorry, it's up here on my calendar.
I'll send
So,
it.
definitely, like, what is it like? Because I've never really had a conversation with an artist and a woman of color. Like, what is it like to be a woman of color and to be an artist? Like, that is your title, that's who you are. That's your bread and butter. Because I'm an avid reader, I read a lot. So anytime I pick up a book and they're depicting an artist, they're usually white. You don't read a lot about black artists. So, like, what is that like? How has it been trying to like get your work out there? And do you see a difference in, your other counterparts that may not be black and may not be women, and how their work is viewed, and then how your work is viewed as well?
Well, when I first started in New York, I started an art, what do you call it? An art group called Sonia, South of the Navy Yard Artists in Brooklyn. And it was a way for artists to get together, stuff like that. And in my mind, I do have to tell you that you do things collectively so that you can be part of something and get your work out, So that being said, you still have to figure out how to navigate. Because mind you, I'm a self-taught artist. Most artists that I was around in Brooklyn went to school. Okay? So to me, I always felt like I had to work harder. You know how they always would say the black tax. Okay?
You gotta work.
So it wasn't just, I never saw it as me being a black woman. That's just a given. If that's your reason for not doing, that's on you, ain't on me. Kind, that's how I have to say, take it things.
Yes.
So then going down to Atlanta, because I went for my mom when she was sick. So this is the thing. It turns into who you know.
Story of our lives.
And not what you know. Okay. Then I mean, I did every little thing. I did all these pieces of artwork that were like and tons of smaller pieces, did a lot of work, living and breathing. And for some reason, the bigger pieces always seem to go off the walls. But I usually use the bigger pieces as to draw people in and then try and sell all these little pieces.
Yes.
Okay, I use that same formula in New Orleans. And then that's where I met my husband, and he turns around and he says, "Do you realize you put just as much work in the smaller pieces
That you
than
do.
you do, they just like you do the bigger pieces? Concentrate on big one." And I was fighting him. I really
Of course.
was.
We don't want to accept it. It's like, no.
Yeah, but at the same time, when I started concentrating on that, it really did make a difference. Because then I had a job at the time, but then just as I started doing the Silver Point, I left the job, we went to Spain, And I've been doing it ever since. And I have to tell you, the amount of work that I've been putting into the pieces actually is worth it. And if you know the artwork, if you know the technique, if you know all that, then it's fine. But you got to actually explain it to people
Yes.
because they're not going to know. Okay, then you turn around, and if you're a black woman, there is a chance that I only know one other black woman that does this work, and her name's Marjorie Williams Smith. And she, the reason I never met her, but I saw her work, and she's my inspiration for the work that I do. You know, and she's another black woman. I don't know any other black women that are doing this. So, to tell you the truth, I just try and do the best work possible. Build it and it will come. That's how I have to say. Because any other time, I can't worry about the small stuff. And when I got to New Orleans, I just really, really tried really hard to do really good work. At the end of the day, if you like it, you like it. If you
If you
don't, you
don't, you
don't. And
don't.
I can't bend over backwards. I also don't, I'm not around a lot of people a lot because I concentrate more on trying to create. I believe that I collect energies. And when you collect other people's energy, there's no room left for you.
I'm the same way. Same way.
And
I spend
so
a lot of time.
you have to limit. My friend Monique just came on, and we've had this conversation in my studio in New Orleans. And I tell you, that energy, you got to be around people who just totally light you up, because when they're gone, you're happy you saw them. You happy that it, because their energies help you create something else, and then you know, things like that. But I limited myself to a lot of people. I mean, to a short list of people. You know, so that being said, I care so much more about creating the work. If you are going to not like me because I'm self-taught, because this is the other thing I forgot to tell you. My work, there's a self-taught dynamic, and it's outsider, and it's more of naive art. So if I go into a place that does self-taught, they don't want me because I'm too refined, you know, and I go, you know, yeah, especially if you're looking for representation or you're looking for somebody to show your work. Their stuff is naive. And I have no problem with naive, but they don't want to take me because I'm too polished.
What a thought.
Yeah. And that has nothing to do with race or sex right there.
That's
You
true.
know? So you got all these things coming at you. And I do have to say, when I left New York, there was one thing. They're very misogynist. You know, I realized that there are more men in the art, and in Atlanta, there were more men supported by women, more men artists supported by women. Those women are the ones who worked hard to get those men into their positions.
Touche.
It was just an observation.
It's crazy that we observe those things, and it's like you observe it and don't even have to say anything, because just like you said, it's about all about who you know, not what you know. And that's what it seems like. And I feel like in a lot of fields that people go to school and get degrees in, it's literally about who you know. Because when you graduate from college, they're not looking at your grade point average.
They're
They're
looking
looking at
at,
the fact that you have the degree. They just want
but
those
it's not
letters
only
up.
that. It's their teachers too. Their teachers and their the faculty and I. Those are the people, because remember, they are supporting their institutions. So these kids, or I don't want to say kids, these professional artists that are out there now, they will look at their alma mater, their student population, because they want to show, well, this is one of my students, or they're from my da 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 da. You know, there's a connection. And I remember somebody said to me, when I was in New Orleans, and I love her dearly, she's such a sweet person, but I didn't know her at the time. And I was recommended for a residency in New Orleans. I'm not going to mention it, but they know what it is. And as I was applying, I didn't get in. And then I met her maybe 6 months, the executive director, 6 months after the fact. And her wording was, "I wish I knew you."
If
I
that
couldn't.
doesn't speak volumes, good Lord.
But then this shows you how good she is. Because at the end of the day, when I did meet her, she explained that so well that I didn't feel defensive. Because the first thing we do is we feel defensive when we don't get what we want.
Yes,
You know?
I can
But
imagine.
I, yeah. And so it's not that I really wanted to get one, but I'm like, well, you didn't look at the work, you know? And, you know, artists are going to do that. My work is, but at the end of the day, you sit there and you go, maybe I wasn't supposed to. That's the greatest thing about life. You can let go of things.
Yeah. Oh, say that
You
again.
sit there
I'm
and you
working on
go,
it, Lord. I'm working on it.
yeah.
I'm working
You go
on
like this. Yeah, you go, yeah, I wanted it, but I didn't get it. God got something else going. Okay, I'll just leave it in his hands.
As soon
You
as
know
I get
what
that mindset, y'all better watch out.
I mean?
I'm working
Let me.
on it. Oh my
You'll
goodness.
get there probably faster than I will, than I
And
did.
look, time's a ticking. I'm ready to be done with it. I'm ready to be over it. So I know we've already touched on, you being self-taught, but and you know how you have to navigate yourself around to get your work out there, but how difficult was it to be self-taught? Because I wouldn't even know where to start.
I've been doing this since I was 5. The only thing is, I do have to tell you, go back to self-taught. It's not so much that it was the self-taught part, it was the part that it was therapy for me. Without anybody looking at it, I used to get bouts of depression, and I would be either writing poetry or doing sketching. And then I would be happy again. You know, life would happen. And then I would get another bout. But the funny thing is that each time I came back to it, I was better than the last. And when I was doing it, you know, my aunt's boyfriend put a pencil in my hand and showed me how to do a stick figure at 5 years old. And I've been doing things, you know, like I've been very interested in people all the time. And so my inspiration is people I create. It's not really difficult. The only thing is that you have to believe in what you're doing. You have to believe that you can get to the other side of drawing that first line. You know what I mean? There are days when I could give up and I go, you know,
It's
they're
like,
just,
why give up? You've made it so far.
well, there are days when you know, there are some, let's just say for me, I always think about, oh, I wanted that so badly. And if you don't get certain things, you feel like you fail.
Yes. Oh gosh, 100%.
But, and then you want to give up. But I don't go into that really bad depression like I did when I was a kid and in my 20s. I just go, and then all of a sudden I sit still for a second. And then I go, something's coming. If I didn't get this, something is coming. I wasn't supposed to get it. I have to remember that. I have to remember that. And so when it goes to the self-taught thing, I just think it's all about evolving from the next to the next to the next to the next. You know, you're gonna make, you know, God knows what I'll be doing next year. You know, like the kind of art that I'll be doing next year, or how if this art actually evolved into a whole nother round of artwork, which it always does. It keeps evolving into another set. So I went from Barna Black, and that was the self-taught process of just sitting there trying to figure out, can I do this? I almost gave up when I was in 2 weeks into Barcelona. I almost gave up.
Don't I do that?
And My husband said we did not travel all of the this
For
way.
you to give up.
Hold on. Then he goes, we could have kept our ass in New Orleans. You know what I mean? So then he turns, I don't know how it happened, but then we just started collecting stuff in the fields, making our own charcoal. From that point to the, I sat there and was like, I think I can do this. So as time went on, what we did do was that we ended up finding what was the perfect charcoal. And then once we got to the perfect charcoal, which turned into like butter, it just made everything better. Then when we came back, it was just we evolved the charcoal into chalk, black chalk, acrylic. And then as time went on, we said, okay, we're not going to do this, we're going to do that. I do it. I call him my research and development guy,
Right.
because he always comes up with things and I go, and then, I'll implement. At the end of the day, I won't give up. I want to as a self-taught artist, but I won't give up because I'm like, there's so much going on in this. I can do this. I can do it.
Yeah, I think for me, especially, at the point in my life where I'm at, I've dipped my, my toes, my fingers into so many different things like modeling. And then, I have my degree in education. And then, I'm a flight attendant. With everything going on in the world, it's like, will I be a flight attendant in 6 months? Because, honey, the way the airlines are looking, I might
I
be
know,
looking
I
somewhere
know, I
else.
know, I
So
know,
I'm
I
just back
know.
about to figure it out. And then it's like, do I want to go back to, do I want to, start teaching again? Or do I want to go back to school? It's like, I'm not. I have gotten to the point in my life where I don't stress because it's like
That's the perfect.
me not having a job, that's the inevitable because that's something that's out of my control. Like a virus came and completely messed up the airline industry. I have no control over that. So the last thing that I can do is sit home and by myself and be in here biting my fingernails down to the nubs and sweating and crying and upset over something that is literally out of my control. There's nothing that I can do. I can grow from it and I can see, you know what? I've had my toes in so many different things. Maybe I should make this my main focus. As being a flight attendant was, guess what? Now I'm getting the opportunity to switch it up. So why not?
This is the time to actually test who you are. This is the time when you have something like this. It really does. And the reason why is because there was something that I just went through where I was going to go back to work. And then I always feel that when it's going against my being, like to literally, just as I applied, I ended up selling two pieces.
See, it was like confirmation.
And I knew it was a test. I knew it was a test. And I'm like, but for some reason, you got to go through the motion. Remember what you like to do the most and be the master of it. Okay? So
She broke me
don't,
down. I wasn't
do
ready.
you get what I mean? Just, you got to be the master, do what you know that's uniquely you, be the master of it, because nobody can be you doing it. You
That's a
bring
word.
more to the table than you realize. And that's my biggest thing. It's like, I used to do everything. When I was in New York, I was in a band. I was doing my music. I mean, my not my music. I was running a gallery. I was doing my art, and I had a full-time job. Okay? And to me, that was what New Yorkers do. You become valuable at everything. And I think as time went on, you actually look, what do you really want to do? Okay. And so as I'm looking at what I really wanted to do, I wanted to be an artist, but I did not want to be the starving artist. I did not want to be the artist that somebody has to take care of me. Or, when I say take care of me, I'm talking about like, on my mother, like my mother didn't raise me for her to be taking care of me. You know what I mean? She did it already. I'm an adult now. So as time goes on, I sat there and I looked at the people in the industry, whether it's music, whether it's writing, whether it's artwork, and I saw what they do. They do it full time, and they're good at it because they do it full time. You know, it's everything they do. And so I said, it's funny, I had a conversation with my husband years later. I was like, if I could just find a patron or something and turn the creation of artwork into dividends, you know, and when I sell a piece of artwork, they get a dividend of it, you know, and I thought about that. And I swear, within 6 months later, we ended up in Spain. You know,
It
it's like
probably just works out.
the dynamics kind of change. And what was very important to me back in the day is not that important, because the other thing that I realized, that being a New Yorker, and not saying all New Yorkers elect this, but I think as a society, we really do concentrate on the material things. And we don't feel validated unless we have the material thing. And that's why you need the extra money for this and the extra money for that. And, you know, at the end of the day, I just sat there and I realized I don't need a 2 or 3 bedroom apartment with a TV in each room, with a stereo in each room. And you know what I mean? It's like I would love it for other things, but it was only me at the time. And I had a 2 bedroom apartment. And you had to see how you downsize things, and then you realize you put value on the wrong things. You're
That is
not putting.
my generation to a T. I think so much in my generation and just how the world is right now, we put so much value on material. And it's just like, okay, what is that material going to get you? What are those material things going to bring to you? Like, what is it going to do for your, it's not going to do anything. You know, you're
It's
making
not.
somebody else rich off of those material things.
I know. And I care so much more about, and as I evolved and started thinking, I cared so much more about the fact that no matter where I go, that's where I'll be. Do you get what I mean? So the art goes wherever I go. The art inside of me will always be there. I can go anywhere and do it. So when I lost everything, because I did lose everything when I got to Atlanta, because it
I
was
lost everything
2008,
too. I had to start all the way over.
and that's the thing. But the feeling that you go through when you lose everything, you feel like your values, your value is so nothing. And then for some reason, all I kept thinking of was, but you're still rich. You still got the art inside of you. Just, you know, it'll happen. May not happen at this moment, but
May not happen when you
who
want it
knows?
to, but it'll happen.
It will happen. And so it's amazing how the last 12 years have been wow. From the moment I lost everything until now, I'm like, who knew? Who knew? But there's such a level of freedom when you're not really pulled down with the material thing. It's also another level of freedom that when you do create, you're actually touching people's souls and you just keep going. You're not doing it to pat yourself on the back. You're doing it because, yes, I did this. You like, okay, good. If it makes you feel good, if you feel like you can be even a better person in your heart and your soul, I'm fine. You know what I mean? I'm fine.
That's a mouthful. And that's, I think I've gotten to the point in my life where, like, when I moved to Chicago 3 years ago for my job, I literally had to start my life over. Like I sold everything I had. Like, you know, I was in college in Tallahassee. I put everything in storage because I had my own apartment, and I literally started from the bottom. It was like I started from the bottom as far as how much I was earning. I started from the bottom as far as, oh, well, you know, I lived by myself, but I'm literally starting at the bottom of the totem pole for my pay. So I got to get 3 other roommates and I got to do this for a year and I got to save my money. Like, I literally started all the way over from moving to Chicago and not knowing anybody. The only person I knew, only people I knew were my roommates. I didn't know anybody, and like a couple of people in my training class. I didn't know anybody else. So when I moved to Chicago, I literally started all the way over from releasing people from my past. I had to leave them where they were at because they weren't willing to grow with me. So I had to literally say, you know what? For my sanity and for my growth as a person, I have to leave you where you are because you're not willing to grow with me. You're not willing to take this journey. So if I sit here and I try to bring you with me, you're going to bring me back down. Because before I moved to Chicago, I was definitely in a rocky place deciding whether I was going to go back to school, if I was just going to work full time, like what was I going to do? And when the opportunity came about for my job, at first I was like, you know what? Nope. I got my mind made up. I'm going back to school. I'm going to get my master's. No. And then I went home for the holidays and it was like an epiphany because my mom was so...
You had an aha moment.
It was an aha moment because my mom was like, baby, you can just stay home. Like, you can even move back home and you can live with us and save our rent. You can take classes online. She was giving me all. She was giving me the good stuff. And then it was like, I was in Walmart with my sister. I will never forget it. We were in Walmart. I was looking for cotton balls and I got on my phone and American Airlines, they sent me an email to set up my interview for them to fly me out. And I literally was like, I told my sister, I said, sis, I'm going to do it. She was like, oh, okay. Because they were both like, oh, whatever. I was like, you know, I'm going to do it. I'm going to see what it's like. And then from the time that I decided that I was going to take that journey, it has been smooth sailing. Literally from leaving Tallahassee. When I tell y'all, I had an apartment. And I only had that apartment for like 3 to 4 months. And I had a year lease. And it was either you pay out that lease, you find somebody to take over your lease, or they gonna send that debt to collections because they want their money. I was like, oh my God, what am I gonna do? The day before I was supposed to pay rent, y'all, somebody subleased that apartment. It was like somebody literally the management called me and was like, you left the apartment so clean. That young lady walked in there, she looked at it and she wanted it. She signed that lease on the spot. It was literally like from when I had that epiphany and decided to listen and take the journey, it was like my life changed.
You listen to the universe.
And I'm so glad I did, because if I would have went against it, only the Lord knows where I would be right now. But it was like when I decided to take that journey and I listened, it was just up from there, from, you know, getting all these opportunities with my company. You know, I did a photo shoot for them. I've been in a campaign and, you know, I've traveled to see the world. You know, I did that when I was younger, but now I'm getting paid to see the world. And it's just like, if I wouldn't have listened, where would I be? And to be where I am now, it's like, it's unbelievable. Sometimes I can't find the words. Like, I just walk around in my apartment sometimes and I'm like, how did I get here? Like, how did I make it here?
The fact that you can actually take a moment and say that is, it tells you the blessing. And I totally believe in that. And the reason why I say that is because you took time to listen. That was the biggest thing.
Man, Lord knows I haven't listened to Jesus my whole life, but it took that one moment. I was like, you know what?
I tell you, but you know what the funniest thing is like when I, when there are things that I have to say, it's my life. I can't turn around and constantly think about what other people think or what other people feel, you know, because if it's that ingrained in you to act upon it, I really do think you should.
Yes.
You know, and you're talking about you moved here and you didn't know anybody. I still know maybe.
How many people I know?
The only reason why I know people for real is because of my job.
That's good. Well, you know, most of I know the people from Gallery Guichard. I keep meeting new people, whatever. I'm the landlord or whatever. But when we got here, hell started breaking loose with, you know, and I was home all the time doing artwork. So, you know, I didn't really pay attention. I thought I was going to have time, and I didn't.
It's
because
everything
just happened. And so everything I've been doing is actually online, which I never thought I would be doing, but it's like now everything is like a reality show online.
Look, everything wants to be a reality show.
I know, I
So there
know.
was one question. Let me tell you.
Yeah.
Let me catch. She sent me a whole look. This is how I need my guests to come. Okay. If I email you and I say, what would you like for us to discuss? You better come with this. Okay. She sent me an email, baby. Okay. So this is something I really, really, really wanted to touch on. How art has been the catharsis, storyteller, and the purveyor of the soul of our people.
Well, think about the sign of the times that we're in right now. We know more about our history now because of the writers, the artists. Okay, when I was growing up, I didn't see a lot. Even though I was raised in Harlem, I knew the black people that I was around, family, neighbors, and stuff like that. But you don't read about it in history. You get a paragraph in this whole book that's this thick. You get to college and you're like, you don't know. And then the funniest thing is, it's like I took African American history 3 times, but the teacher was so volatile because I did not like how he was teaching. He was turning people against and angry towards each other. It drove me crazy. The fourth time I took it, you're gonna laugh. It was a gay, white, British teacher.
But he knew what he was talking about.
He knew everything. But then, if you think about it, there are more people around the world that know our history at the time, that knew our history more than we knew. We didn't know it. And then on top, so then go to the other side of this. So you're happy that you're seeing so much happening in your history class, but then, and this is the black people, but the white people were fighting it because they were not, they thought it was lies of the things that this particular man was telling him. And and then as time went on, the greatest thing about being in the South for the amount of time, especially New Orleans, they know their history inside out
Back
in
with
ways
all
that
of
they
that.
do. Yeah, they know their history inside out because guess what? It's their descendants, it's their ancestors. It's kind of almost immediate, one line down, So they can actually tell. And if it's not their descendant, it's their neighbor's descendants or their, you know what I mean? There, it's in New Orleans, everything feels like it cannot be past a 2 degree. That's how intense the culture is with the history. And it's in the artwork, it's in the writing, it's in the music.
Oh, the
These
music.
things. So think about how these three things have actually turned into a phenomenal way that people were able to preserve their culture without anybody fighting them. And that is how I see it. Now, I've gone through my own, like depression, whatever, when I was in college. I do have to say that at one point, you're trying to prove that you are a good person, And at one point, I woke up in the middle of the night in one of my bouts of depression, and I said, no matter what I do, they're always going to see a black person.
Regardless, they're going to see that before they see anything else.
And to me, I'm like, okay, so. You know what I mean? And it's like, I have no control over that.
None.
All I have control over is me. That took a whole lot of weight off of my shoulder. I know what I know. I know what I like. I know what I love to do in life. Okay? Just the same things, just I'm older. But I do have to tell you, that freed me up. Because I refuse to let anybody tell me anything less about, well, you're different from those people, or you're this. What else is in you? You know what I mean? There's a certain separation that they try. Okay, you can be a little bit of black, but you don't really act black. But
You
as
don't
time
talk like
goes on, as time goes on, the one thing that you definitely have to say is you just need to know more black people, because apparently I know more white people than you know more black people.
That's the
And tell you,
problem.
but the thing that I can tell you is that it's not about the white people. When I look at white people, I'm like, he's Jewish, he's Italian, he's the, because they bring a different mix to the table. It's the WASP, I guess, that you think about. So in the black community, you have Jamaican, you have Southern, you have Brazilian,
You
you
have
have that.
Nigerian, you got
And we and you have Nigerian. Oh,
Haitian, and man, we could go from cotton.
Senegalese, because I love Senegalese food. And the thing that gets me is that each one of them, no matter what race you are that they put you in, they bring a whole nother dynamic to it, And so at the end of the day, I sit there and I go, I can't think like that. It's going to drive me bonkers, especially if you're going around with a little bit of free thought in your head.
Yes. I
Okay?
got a lot of free thought up here.
When you have the free thought because you know other cultures, if you have not known other cultures and you only know your culture, if a tree fell in the forest, are you gonna know?
There you go. Nope, wouldn't have a clue.
So I have to totally feel that in order for any sort of healing to know, I mean, any sort of healing to happen, is to know that there's a hell of a lot more to the spices in this meal that we are making to make it a good meal.
That's all I'm trying to say.
That's
There's
all,
so
you
much
know what I mean?
more. There's so much more that we just, and my friends and I, man, we had a heated conversation the other day because it's like, how can we fix the question is, oh, everybody, how can we fix it? And like I, there are so, and like we all agree, there are so many moving parts. There's so much that everybody doesn't know. And like just like you said, our history. You know, a lot of black people, we don't even know where our ancestors come from, because I don't have a clue. People stop me on the street all the time and they're like, are you, well, what are you?
Okay, there you
People
go.
always like stop me on the street and they're like, what are you? And I'm like, well, as far as I know, I'm black, and I don't know what else is mixed up in there. You know, I gotta do some ancestry DNA to find out. But it's like, I don't know. And it's
So
crazy
you
that I
could say, but
can.
at the moment, I'm me.
There you go, honey. At the moment, you get an Allison because I don't know whatever what else is mixed up in the pot. So I
I
see
know.
that we have our timer. We have about a
Oh,
minute and
yeah.
27 seconds. Let me tell you, we might have to do a part two, y'all, because this just, whew, this was
I
good.
don't
And we all, look, me and my friends, we already knew it was going to be juicy. We already
bother.
knew this was going to be exactly what we all needed for the culture, folks.
I'm so glad.
So I want to thank
I
you.
had fun.
I want to thank you so much because you brought so much to the table. You got me over here like, you know what? I need to write some stuff down. I got to figure some stuff out. I need to just meditate. I need to listen to the universe and see what's coming
Me
next.
meditate.
Yes.
I've been doing it, and it's bringing forth a lot of abundance. That's the other thing, we don't know how abundant we are. We don't know because nobody told us. We live in lack, but we don't live in abundance. We need to live in abundance. Let me tell you, the world will be a hell of a lot better place.
Wouldn't it? Okay, I'm gonna title this Live in Abundance. I love that. Okay, I
Please
see
do
what I'm
so.
doing.
Please
So
do
I
so.
thank you so much. This was
Thank
everything
you.
that I needed and more. You're gonna send me
Anything.
the info and then I'm gonna
I
share it to
will.
the world for the show that is going to be next month. You know, next month is tomorrow. And I thank you so much. You have a beautiful
And
evening.
look at my Patreon page. I have a Patreon page, so
Oh, of
look that
course. I'm
Patreon.
checking it all out. Thank you so
Okay.
much for coming.